Hallelujah. You know, a lot of places, you know, that we go to, Pastor mentioned that it was dry and empty and religious and everything that comes with that. And wow. And we have to we just have to, I guess. You know, a lot of times I'll tell people, you know, by the end of the week it's going to be, you know, it's going to be very hard for you to stay sick, very hard for you to stay depressed, very hard for you to stay bound up, ugly, whatever. But because the glory comes. But I promise you, I won't be saying that here. And you know, it's I'll be honest, it's very, 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 very seldom that you go to a place to where you, as soon as you step up, you step in, if you know what I mean. I mean, as soon as you get up behind the pulpit, I mean, you're, actually, forget, it's not even about getting behind the pulpit, it's just getting in, coming in and walking into the sanctuary where the glory of God is. To where you finally walk into a place to where it's pure worship and not a performance. To where the sanctuary's, it's not a theater. Where the people are not looking for the applause and the praise of men, but where the Spirit of God is free to walk up and down the aisles and in between the rows and do whatever he wants to do for however long he wants to do it. Just how God planned it. You know, it's, for some reason, it's amazing how you listen to many today, Pentecost was limited to the upper room with 120 people. And you don't get much more about him than that. But yet, God's purpose and God's blueprint and God's plan is for us to live that way. Amen. Not for a certain time, but for all times. It's for every time. It's for now. And it's amazing how life is when you learn to live it in the Spirit. It's amazing how life is when you learn to you get your orders from Him and your marching orders from Him, and you don't do anything because it's a good idea or because it sounds good. No, you do it because thus saith the Lord. And with that always comes his power. You understand, with that always comes his glory. And I'm truly honored to be here. Your pastor is such, and his precious wife, Ann, they're such dear to our hearts. And I look forward to coming here every time. I'll be honest with you, it's a high water mark for me to come here and to not just for the church, but just to hang around your pastors. And I will tell you, every time I get around him, he challenges me. But that's a good thing. That's a good thing. And I'm challenged, and I'm provoked. But that's a good thing. People that are hungry for God and want all of Him want that, because if there's anything in your life that's there or any thinking that you've developed that's not right, listen. If it's not of God, you want it gone. Amen. Amen? And so, you know, it's amazing how people come and they get told the truth and they get an attitude and they leave. But they stay bound up. Freedom only comes where there's truth. Amen? And many people have adopted a lie and they believe that lie, and that lie has become the truth for them, but it's still a lie. Because you remember what Jesus said, when you abide in Him, abide in the Word, then you become His disciples, and you'll know the truth. And the truth shall what? But that only comes as you abide in Him, and abide in the Word. Amen? It's amazing how people often will say, well, you know, the truth will set you free, but that's not what it says. You got to be in Him. You got to be abiding in Him. You got to be abiding in the Word and become His disciple. Then you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Amen? But understand, if there's a truth that sets you free, then there has to be a lie that binds. And so many people, it's amazing to me how so many people have adopted that in their life. It's really just a lie, and it produces what lie produces, but yet they think it's the truth, but they stay bound up. So for me, I am so hungry. I tell you, I promise you this morning, and one thing that I'm so glad about this place is there's no clock on the back of the wall. I'm not told I have a certain amount of time. But I promise you, listen, you'll get to eat today. You'll get to eat. But I can promise you this, by the time you get to the restaurant, all the Catholics and the Baptists and the Presbyterians, they have done gone in and eaten and left. And you're going to have the whole place to yourself. So just relax. Oh, hallelujah. You know, one of the things in the natural that I've been provoked with your pastor, I was sort of sad, but yet it's truth, but I'm glad for the truth, but I'm sort of sad to let it go, but I know I have to. There's no more In-N-Out Burgers or Chick-fil-A. I mean, anyway. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. You know, I do just want to just say, too, that we have some dear, dear friends with us today, all the way from, well, many places, Tampa, Paris. We were with them in Paris in March, I believe it was, and dear friends of ours, Dale and Lucy. Just stand up. Everybody see. And Isaac, their son. Is there three seats available where they can come sit up here? Come up here. No, it's too late. I done said it in front of everybody, so now you got to come. Come as thou hitherest. Hallelujah. You guys have moved here, haven't you? Hallelujah. Right here. Front row. I did that so everybody can see as you walk down the aisle. Front row, hallelujah. Actually, Oh yeah, they're from. They used to work at with Pastor Rodney Howard Brown at the Tampa Bay Church, or River of Tampa Bay, and we were in March, we were in February. Hallelujah. Whew, my reso korabashista. Ha, in sometime. When was it? March. We were in Paris, France. And they were teaching there in the Bible school there. So it's good to see you guys. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. And so you're going to come here to plug in the body place. Yeah, I promise you, you won't find a better place than this place. I can promise you that. Amen. So hallelujah. Just get ready to be provoked in many, many ways. Just be sure that you eat healthy before you get around Pastor Mark. Hallelujah. That's a good thing, actually. I want you to go with me. Now I need to stay in the Holy Ghost. Go with me to the book of Matthew, if you would. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, one of the things that we have to stay is hungry for the Lord. You know, the Lord touched me many years ago, and you know, I entered the ministry, as the pastor said earlier, in 1985. But I don't like to count the first 5 years of the ministry, even though we traveled and did crusades and did revival meetings, what I thought was a revival at the time. You know, we'd go around the country and having miracle crusades and just didn't have any miracles, and. I don't know if you know what it's like to have a miracle ministry with no miracles, but I can tell you all about it. And I think the thing that's even scarier is it took me 5 years to realize it was a problem. And so I cried out to the Lord. I did. I actually didn't want to do it anymore. I was never angry at the Lord. I've never one time been angry at the Lord. I've met people and they say, you know, they just got an attitude and they're just angry at the Lord. And I don't know where to put that. That's just stupid. I mean, that's just stupid. I mean, that's just, where do you put that? How can you be mad at someone that's so good? All he is good. He's nothing but good. Amen? I mean, he has no beginning. He has no end. His goodness is beyond anything we can imagine. It has no beginning. His goodness has no beginning, has no end. Because he has no beginning, he has no end. I mean, how can you be mad at someone that's so good? Amen? And I tell people, you're just mad at the wrong person. That's just stupid. I mean, to be mad at God is just, I mean, to call that stupid, it's an insult to stupid people. That's just stupid. But I wasn't angry at the Lord. I just didn't want to do this anymore because I was tired of getting up telling people we're going to have things happen, but nothing happens. I was tired of telling people we're going to have a move with the Spirit of God, and the only thing we have is the only move is people moving in their seats because they're tired of listening to me and they want to go. I mean, that's no miracles, nothing. And so I said, Lord, this is not working, and I don't want to do this anymore. And so I said to the Lord, I'm just going to go drive race cars. That's what I'm going to do because that's how I grew up. That's what my family did. That was my dream in life. As a kid, I ate it, I slept it, I drank it. Everything was racing because I lived at the racetrack. I mean, that was my church. I didn't grow up in church. I grew up at the racetrack. And I love it to this day. I love the smell. I sometimes go by myself. I just love the smell of it. I mean, I love the smell of burnt oil and gas and rubber. And if I could develop a cologne to smell like that, I'd wear it. I mean, I love that. And to me, it's like, oh. I know it's just part of how you grow up. That's how I grew up. And so I like going fast. And we won't talk about the 5 tickets I got in 1 year, but I like going fast. So I said, Lord, let me just do that. Let that be the platform that you use me to, you know, get people saved and so forth, so on. And the Lord said, no. I said, Lord, then you have to do something in my life. And the Lord did. And I'm going to share a lot of it tonight. And the Lord did. But I can tell you that the Lord touched me after getting so hungry for the Lord. And that's the thing that we have to understand. It's not just about getting hungry because you want something. No, it's staying hungry. You never stop being hungry. You never stop being hungry and you never stop seeking. And I think that's the biggest disconnect with most Christians is that they stop being hungry and they stop seeking. And I want you to go with me to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. For no man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they are? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. There's one thing that we have to get right. And this one thing is the very centerpiece of Christianity. It's the very centerpiece of our purpose in life. It's the very centerpiece of living a godly life. It's the very centerpiece of living a victorious life. And that one thing that we have to get right, which most Christians are disconnected from, but the one thing that we must get right is that he has to be first, and we must seek first his kingdom. But yet so many today in Christian circles, they got it backwards. They seek the things. They seek the money. They seek the things. And they think that's what you have to do in order to so forth advance God's kingdom or whatever. But yet they got it backwards. And they wonder, why can't they be blessed? Why can't they walk in what they're supposed to walk in? Why aren't they having what they're supposed to be having? Because you got things backwards. You're seeking the things and not seeking him. He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. And I see it so everywhere we go. But he has to be first. He has to be priority. He has to be number one. Not just in certain areas of your life, in every single area of your life, he must be first. Remember in Proverbs chapter 3, acknowledge him in all your ways and he'll direct your path. In all your ways, in everything you do, acknowledge him and he'll direct your path. He is first. He must be first. He must be consumed in our thinking. Everything we do has to be a result of seeking him. Everything we do has to be a result because we're consumed with him. People say, well, how much do you think of the Lord? I think of him all the time. I'm constantly thinking of him. I'm constantly cautious of him. And to be honest with you, this is one of the things that happened with me, because I was so tired of, as Lord, if you're calling me, then Lord, then first off, something has to happen in me. And I'll be honest with you, I begin to cry out to him and I begin to seek him. For a year and a half, I begin to seek him. And what the Lord does with us and what the Lord does through us, listen, never happened because I asked for it. I didn't ask for the fire. I didn't ask for a supernatural ministry. I never asked the Lord that, Lord, give me a ministry that wherever we go, that the meetings go 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 weeks. I never asked for that. I never asked the Lord, give me a ministry to where we're going to start with 400 people and after 4 weeks we have 1,500 people. I never asked for that. I never asked for a ministry to where we come into the place and people that will be bound up. People will be bound up in sin. People will be bound up with sickness and disease. I don't even pray for them, but the power of God begin to fall and they'll be instantly be healed. I never prayed for that. I never asked for it. I wanted to know him. I wanted to know him. I had to know him more than anything, because he's the source. And so many times people want to seek what comes from him instead of seeking him. So many times people seek the power, but they don't seek him. But yet, everything comes from him. That's why he has to be number one. And nothing will work properly in your life until you get this one thing right. He has to be first. In every area, he has to be first. And I just held on to Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13. And this is the scripture that I came after the Lord with everything. I mean, everything. I mean, listen, I laid aside everything. I said, Lord, you are everything to me. Everything's not everything. You're everything to me. And I'm going to come after you with everything I have, everything I got, my whole being. I'm coming after you. And I'm not going to stop. And you know what? And we haven't stopped. Listen, that's why I said earlier, you're looking at a very hungry man. You're looking at a very hungry preacher. I'm so hungry. There's so much more. And that's the thing. Once you begin to taste, you realize, oh, my God, what have I been missing out on? There's so much more. There's so much more. You will never come to the place in him to where you exhaust it, because he's endless. And you just want to seek more and just want to seek more and just want to seek more. And Jeremiah 29 verse 13, the Lord said to us, if you seek me, you shall find me when you search for me with all of your heart. That's a promise that was given to us by God. He said, if you seek me, you will find me. If you seek me, you will find me. If you search for me with all your heart, you'll find me. I mean, think about it. How many people just look at that? And first off, many Christians don't even know that even exists in the Word. But yet, how even those that do, how many people just hear it and yeah, it's wonderful. No, God's given us a challenge. God says, come after me. Come after me. Seek me. And very few take him up on it. But I can promise you, you're looking at somebody that's taking him up on it. I promise you, your pastor's taking him up on it. And there's others, but there's few do. But the Lord promised, listen, he is not a liar. He said, if you come after him, you seek him first. You seek first his kingdom. You seek him and search for him with everything on the inside of you. You come after him. He promised you that you would find him. That's what he said. And then the next verse, the first part of verse 14, he says, and I'll be found of you, meaning this, when you fizz, every one of you can walk in the power of God. Every one of you can walk in the miracles. Every one of you can walk in the glory of God. It really just comes down to one thing. How hungry are you and how bad do you want him? That's really what it comes down to. How bad do you want him? But you got to find him who's the source of all. And he said that I'll be found of you. I remember a few years ago, there's a businessman I know, and the Lord supernaturally blessed him in a wonderful way, and I mean, he's doing very well. And he called me up and he said, I just got back from some country, and he called me up and he said, hey, what are you doing? I said, man, I'm gonna be honest with you, I'm tired. I'm gonna take about 10 days off before I go out to the next meeting. And he said, really? And he said, what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to play golf every day. I'm going to play golf. That's my exercise, yes. That's my workout plan. Playing golf. That's what I do. And, you know, I'm still trying to convince my wife that's what I do, but that's why I came. That's one of the reasons why I came here, for Pastor Mark to help me on that. But, so I did. I said, I'm just going to play golf every day. And he said, man, I've been working so hard. And he said, man, let me fly you to Houston. And he said, I'll tell you what, I'll take off and let me fly you to Houston. We'll just play golf. Get in on Thursday. We'll play golf Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And then I'll fly you back home. And he said, look, we'll play golf during the day. Man, I'll take you to this phenomenal steakhouse at night. He said, listen, just pray about it and get back with me this afternoon and let me know. I said, no, I'll be there. I'll be there. I mean, some things you don't have to pray about, you know what I mean? I mean, so. So Pastor Mark, I got on a plane and flew there, and sure enough, we played golf. Went to a nice steakhouse that night. I mean, I think the steak, I mean, it's just, anyway, it's amazing steak. And well, then that night, but it started getting cold. It started getting cold and started raining, and no more golf for the rest of the week. And I'm like, oh, man. He said, bro, buddy, I'm sorry. We're not going to be able to play golf anymore this week. And I said, so I'm just going to call in some of my executives and have some meetings, and, you know, we just hang out for the weekend with me. I'm like, I want to go home. I mean, I don't care that I was staying in a 5-star Galleria Hotel in downtown Houston. I live in hotels. That mean nothing to me. But I'm stuck there now. So sure enough, he called his executives in. Came from California, some from New York, some from Louisiana, from Texas, all over. And they're all heathen. Every one of them heathen. Every one of them. And so he said to me, look, this was on Saturday. So he said, look, go to the meeting with me. I said, I don't want to go to your meeting. I said, no, I'll just stay here. Just let me know when you're done and call me and we'll go have steak. And I don't want to go to your meeting. And because first off, all he's going to do is talk about how they need to make more money. And I'm thinking, how much more money? I mean, you're already making $150,000 a week take home. How much more money do you need? I'm like, I don't want to go. I don't want to go hear you. I said, I don't want to go sit for 3 hours and listen to you pump them up, motivate them, and get more money, make more money, get their salesman out making more. I don't want to do that. So you just call me when you're done. About 20 minutes later, the Lord spoke to me. The Lord said, I want you to go to the meeting. And you know what? I know the Lord's voice. I don't argue with the Lord. He's everything to me. When he speaks, I do it. Amen? And besides that, I've tried in the past arguing, and he always wins. Always. He always wins. And even when I was associate pastor in upstate New York, I didn't want to go. I'm a Southern boy. I want to go up there with them Yankees? I don't want to go up there. That's what I said to the Lord. I said, Lord, okay, I'll be associate pastor, but in the South, not in New York. It didn't work. So, I mean, I don't even argue with the Lord now. When he speaks, I do it. Amen? And you should be that way too. As soon as he speaks, you do it. Soon, don't grieve him. As soon as he speaks, you do it. Amen? But when he's first, that's what you do. Now, when he's first, the moment he speaks to you, you do it. When he's first, because he's priority. Amen? He's priority. And so I said, okay, Lord, I'll do it. So I went there, and I'll be honest with you. I mean, I braced myself. I said, okay, I know I'm going to be here for a long time listening to this guy, you know, about money. And so I had my boots on, and I became redneckish. You know what I mean? I became redneck. I had my jeans on. I had my boots on, and I sat in the chair, these chairs, and I leaned back on against the wall on two legs, just leaning back like this, just rocking back and forth. And and he got up, and sure enough, what I thought he started to do. And but he only did it for about 10 minutes. And I was actually a little sick because I'm hearing all of them, they're all heathen. Let's trust me. Where they're going after the business meeting, they're heathen, trust me. And because every one of them, all 25 of them, were going to some strip club. And I was talking about this one guy's bragging about how he's got this $2,500 jacket on. And yeah, he's got a $250,000 wardrobe. He's 25 years old, making $50,000 a week. And I'm listening. I'm like, oh, it's making me sick. I'm like, let me give you the name of my ministry. I was getting sick just listening to them talk. But the Lord spoke to me. The Lord said, I want you to be in that meeting. And so, but I'm leaning against the chair, and he got up and did what I thought, but he only did it for like 10 minutes. And then he stopped. He said, look, I have a dear friend of mine that's with me. He travels all over the world. I'm going to have him come talk to you right now. And as soon as he said that, boom, they all turned and looked at me. And I'm in my boots, like ostrich boots, like you got on, and I'm leaning on them back, two legs on the chair. And I slowly brought the chair back down. And I'm like, okay, Lord, what am I supposed to say to these people? Because they're all heathen. They're going to a strip club. When I'm done, Lord, talking. And so the Lord didn't say anything to me. So you know what I did? I just picked up where the guy left off, the businessman left off, and I started talking about money. But here's what I said. I said, my Father, my God, is the one who gives the ability to get wealth. But his blessings don't add sorrow. What you get with your hands, the blessings you create add sorrow to it. But the blessings that my Father gives adds no sorrow. And he's the one that gives the ability to get the wealth. And I said this. I said, you know, you can make all the money in the world you want. And this is exactly what I said. I said, you can make all the money in the world you want. But you know what? You can make enough money to buy yourself a nice, big, beautiful home or a nice, big, beautiful house, but it can't buy you a home. I said, you can make so much money that you can buy yourself a nice, big, beautiful diamond ring, but it can't buy you love. I said, you can buy yourself a nice, big, beautiful wedding, but it can't buy you a marriage. I said, your money can do a lot of things in this life, but it can do nothing for you in the next life. Whew, I promise you, the moment I said that, I promise you the glory of God came in. I just felt, I just like right now, that same fire that was on me, that's on me right now, that same fire hit me in that room, in that five-star hotel gallery in Houston, Texas. And the glory, and I felt, I'm going to use a term that you understand. I felt clothed. You know what I mean? I felt like I'm home. I felt, oh, I know this. I experience this almost every day of my life. This is the fire of God. This is the glory of God. I know exactly what to do. And listen, in the moment the glory of God came in, the Lord gave me a word of knowledge. I said, there's somebody here, you need a miracle in your heart. You need a miracle in your heart. You need a new heart. As soon as I said that, a guy raised his hand like that. I just raised his hand. I'm like, excuse me? I wasn't expecting that fast. You know what I mean? I'm sorry. Did I spit on you? I didn't mean to. Just mix faith with it and it'll heal you. But that's bad. That's bad. But no, I didn't expect it. I mean, boom, his hand went up. I don't even get that in church. I said, sir, you got a new heart? You need a new heart? He said, yeah, I need a, and he told me what was going on. He needed a new heart. I said, well, come up here now. The Lord's going to touch you and God's going to heal you and give you a new heart. You should have saw everybody's eyes. They get like this. But he jumped up. I mean, he jumped up, and he comes, stood right in front of me. And I said to him, I said, now I'm going to take my hand and lay my hands on you, because right now my hands burn like fire, just like it is right this moment, same then. I said, the moment I lay my hand upon you, see, remember God said, if you seek me, you'll find me when you search for me with all your heart, and I'll be found of you. Right. Yes. Remember, wherever you go, he's there. Right. And guess what? He wants to display his goodness, he wants to display his mercy, and he wants to display his power. Yes, for one reason, so that we can get the harvest in. And I said, I'm going to lay my hand on you because my hand's right now burning with fire. That's the power of God. As soon as I lay my hand upon you, the power of God's going to go in you and God's going to heal you and going to give you a new heart. I said, are you ready? He goes, yes, I'm ready. I'm like, wow, I'm going to get around the heathen more often. And I said, close your eyes. I'm just in a revival mode now. I said, close your eyes, lift your hands. He goes, I'm like, that don't even happen in a lot of churches. But I promise you, as soon as I laid my hand on him, the power of God went in him. I mean, I know, I minister with a tangible anointing. I know when the anointing of God goes into people. I know when people fall down because the power of God went in them, and I know when people fall down because they want my hand off their head, and they're giving me a courtesy drop. Don't do that. I know the difference because I feel it, because I minister with that tangible anointing. I feel it, just like now. And as soon as I laid my hands on him, the power of God went into him. And I promise you, what I'm about to tell you, well, everything I told you is the truth, but what I'm about to tell you is even more radical. And listen, I promise you, that when I tell you this, word for word, it happened just like I'm going to tell you. And when we get to heaven, I'll have the Lord play a DVD for you to show you that what I'm about ready to happen to tell you happened just like I'm telling you. When I laid my hands on him, the power of God went into him. And here's what he did. Ah! Screamed. I mean, but louder than that. Boom! He hit the ground. I mean, I heard a thug. I mean, there's no ushers. There wasn't ushers. It's not a church service. It's a bunch of heathen going to go to a strip club. He hit the ground. Boom! The power of God hit him. And he starts weeping. But when the power of God hit him and he hit the ground, the guy that was sitting beside him, who was the one with the $2,500 jacket and $250,000 Rolls Royce, the one that made me sick, he hit the ground. He fell on his face, and he starts screaming. I promise you, he starts screaming as he's beating the ground with tears and snot and everything coming out. All over his jacket and everywhere. I actually started laughing. I'm thinking $2,500 jacket full of snot. I actually started laughing at it, but you had to be there. But he's screaming. Oh my God! He's screaming. I mean, listen, so loud that the Galleria Hotel, they called security up to the room. Security came to the room. I watched them open the door. As soon as they opened the door, here's this one guy, the power of God's all over him. God just gave him a new heart. The other guy's screaming, oh my God, their eyes get real big, and they look at each other, and they took off running. They didn't even come in. Security. This security. They didn't even come in. They just took off running. And the guy is screaming. But I'm serious. Listen, all it happened just like this. I'm not adding anything to it. It happened just like I'm telling you. But he's screaming, oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, my God, as he beats the floor. And the power of God filled that room. Every single one of them got touched. Now, I don't know how long it lasted. I don't know if it was 20 minutes. I really don't know how long it lasted. And you don't care, I was in the glory of the Lord. I didn't care. But you know what? Eventually they was able to get up. And when they got up, they're all 25 of them staring at me. Their eyes ain't even blinking. They're just looking at me. And I said to them, I said, you've just tasted the goodness of God and the power of God. And one reason he's come to demonstrate you because he loves you. But there's something else he wants, and he wants your life. And he wants to come and invade your life. And he wants you to live for him for all your days and serve him. Because there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shine. I said, how many of you want to make the Lord Jesus the Lord of your life? As soon as I said it, I promise you would think it was rehearsed, Pastor Mark. You would think it's rehearsed. As soon as I said, how many of you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life? All 25 of them, without me saying anything except how many of you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life, all 25 of them went to their knees and they bowed on their knees. I didn't tell them to do that. It's like there was 25 angels behind each one of them just pushed them to the ground. And you know what? I prayed, and every single one of them made Jesus the Lord of their life that night. Many of them got filled with the Holy Ghost that night. And guess what? Afterwards, they said, where are you going? I said, well, I'm going with your boss, and we're going to have a steak. Guess what? All 25 of them, they didn't go to the strip club. Guess where they came? They came with me to have a steak dinner that night. And you know what? And for the next many hours, all they asked me is questions about Jesus and about God and tell them in their life. It's like, I mean, some of them start confessing things. I don't need to know all that. Just know that you're born again right now. But it was pretty amazing. But the point I'm making is this, is that God has to be first. And the moment you make him first and begin to seek him with everything on the inside of you, all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, the moment you begin to seek him, you'll be amazed at what you'll find begin to happen in your life. Because many Christians have it backwards. Many Christians seek the things. They seek the money. They seek the job. They seek everything. They seek it backwards. But you got to seek him first. He has to be first. He has to be number one. He has to be first. That's why in every area of your life, you have to act. You got to make sure that you're doing what he's telling you to do, not what you want to do, not because somebody else tells you it's a good thing, not because it sounds like a good idea. You got to make sure that he's in it. Yes. Yeah. Amen. And I'll be honest with you, just because it's good doesn't mean it's pleasing to him. And we see that with in the book of Revelations, the second chapter, when the Lord, and the first chapter, when the Lord comes and he comes to John, as John's exiled on the Isle of Patmos, tried to boil him, but he wouldn't boil. Every disciple was a martyr. They tried to kill John, but they couldn't, so they exiled him on the Isle of Patmos. But even as he was exiled on the Isle of Patmos, the Bible says that he was in the Spirit. See, you don't ever have to be out. Even as he's in exile, he's in the Spirit. You don't ever have to get out. And I know this sounds so foreign to many Christians because, to be honest with you, many churches are already let go. They're already gone because they got them in. They hurried up and got them in for their hour. But unfortunately, they came in bound up and they're leaving bound up. They came in sick and they're leaving sick. Many of them come in, then you have no conviction whatsoever of the lifestyle they're living. But it's impossible where the glory of God is. It's impossible to live a life that's not clean and holy before God when you're in his presence. Because you will be convicted of it, which is a good thing. Conviction's a good thing. It's like Pastor Mark and I was talking about last night. Listen, condemnation's from religion. Condemnation, why it's so bad, first off, it doesn't give you a way out, but conviction gives you a way out. Well, the conviction gives you a way to victory and freedom, amen? And so here the Lord Jesus comes to John, and of course we get this glorious description of our Lord in Revelation chapter 1. I love it especially when John begins to describe Jesus and begins to describe as he looked into his eyes and saw fire. Because that's what he is fire. And it's amazing how many Christians don't have no idea what the fire of God is. They have no idea what the fire of the Holy Ghost is. But yet, my Bible says that if we are believers, we must be baptized in that fire. We should not be a strangers to that fire. We should not be strangers to the things of God. We should not be strangers to that which pertains to the kingdom. We should not be strangers to that which pertains to the Holy Ghost. But so many, unfortunately, are. That's why, don't take for granted what you have, especially here. Personally, I believe that no one should be allowed behind a pulpit if they're not baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost. No one should even be able to be an usher if they're not baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost. Because that's a requirement for believers to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues. Amen? That should be the requirement for every Bible school student getting out of Bible school. If you don't have no fire, then you don't need to graduate. No, I'm serious. This is all I can be. I'm totally serious about it. So what? You got the mechanics of things. So what? What's that going to do? I had the mechanics for 5 years and went around the country having miracle crusades, and all I had is the mechanics and no miracles. And we live in such a society where everything's about information, 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 information. I mean, my goodness, you could go on YouTube and learn to do most anything. I mean, you could go on YouTube and learn how to change the oil in your car. But guess what? That don't make you a mechanic. But yet you can go and learn how to do it. Why? Because it's information. And that's how most people are about God. They got information about Him, which a lot of it is wrong, but yet they got information. But listen, it's not about information. It's about intimately knowing Him. That's the very foundation of what all Christianity is. That's the very foundation of our whole life, is that we seek Him and we have a relationship with Him. That's the center of all Christianity, is that we have a relationship with God, which is the very thing that separates us from all other religions of the world. You can't become Muslim and take on the nature of Allah. You can't become Buddha and take on the nature of Buddha. But you can make Jesus the Lord of your life and take on the nature and become the nature of God. Because His very nature comes and lives on the inside of you. You become partakers of His very life. Amen. That's why Jesus came. I've come that you might have life. I've come that you might have the life of God. No other religion of the world does that. Only Christianity. Amen. So John, I love John, sees, he looks into the Lord's eyes and flames of fire. That's why, I'll be honest with you, that's why I don't believe a lot of people when they say, well, the Lord appeared to me. I don't believe them. I don't, because they talk too flippantly about it. Yeah. Well, you know, I was praying and the Lord came and appeared to me. I don't believe them. Because people, I do know people that the Lord's appeared to. But when they talk about it, you feel it. You feel it. No, I mean, wherever you are in the car, whatever, the car just becomes full of the glory of God. You feel it. And you hear it in their voice. And you know what I'm talking about? And they're not talking so flippantly about it. I promise you, He come and appear to you, won't be able to talk about it for a while because you just look in the eyes of fire. That's why I promise you, when Moses went and stood before Pharaoh, Moses had an encounter with God. He had a burning bush experience. I promise you, when Moses went and stood before Pharaoh, I promise you, Pharaoh saw the fire of God in Moses' eyes. You can't get where he is and not get who he is. And that's the very thing that one of the things that the Lord was said to the church, said to the seven churches. Actually, out of the seven churches, five of them was rebuked. The only ones that wasn't rebuked was the faithful church and the persecuted church. But yet, they all did have one thing that the Lord said to all of them, and that was, hear what the Holy Ghost is saying. Because he is speaking. And I don't believe he's speaking one thing there and one thing here and one thing here. I believe he's speaking one thing. And those that are connected to him and hear from him will hear the one thing that he's saying to the body of Christ. Amen. And we have to hear because he's speaking. I know I was talking, you pastor and I mean, we're eating at this fish house last night. I mean, my gosh, I don't even cry. I'm wanting to just bawl like a baby because, I mean, just the presence, he's drunk in the Holy Ghost. I'm like, I can't even talk. And it has nothing to do with anything but talking about our Father. You know what? When you talk about it, he comes and going to find out what you're saying about him. And here in that fish house, we stayed down. I know they probably couldn't wait for us to get out of there so they can put some more people in the table. But we just stayed there for I don't know how long, for a while, but just talking about the things of God. I didn't want to leave. But yet, his presence was right there. And yet I remember telling him of that. I feel that the Spirit of God's been speaking to me now because there's a line being drawn. There's a line being drawn. Because I believe with all of my heart the end is at hand. When is it? I don't know. We need to live ready. And we need to live busy about our Father's business. Amen. We need to live ready. We need to live pure. We need to live clean. Amen? And we need to be about our Father's business. You know the one thing that you should fear? Here's the one thing you should fear. You should fear because you're going to stand before God. We are, all of us. One day we're going to stand before God. We're going to give an account of our life. But we should fear this, that when we stand before him, that we were successful in doing what we wanted to do instead of being successful in doing what he wanted us to do. Because there's many people, they go to these motivational stuff and they go to these motivational seminars and they get told a bunch of garbage. It's just a bunch of regurgitated garbage. How they're told that you can do whatever you want. First off, if you think that you can do anything that you want, then you don't have a heart that serves God. Because you can't do whatever you want to do. Especially when you're totally sold out to him and seeking him with everything on the inside of you. You don't do what you want. You do what he wants you to do. And they tell, go stand in the mirror and say, you can do all things. You can do. No, you can't do all things. You don't have enough power. You can't do anything you want in the natural. You can't. Paul said, I know in whom I have believed. We knew what Paul's trust was. And yet, what was it that the Lord said to Brahman Shifrebasistevrebosusta? What is it that the Lord said to Hezekiah? Hezekiah, what am I? I didn't even talk. What Hezekiah? Where'd that come from? Not Hezekiah. Jeez. Hezekiah. Where's Hezekiah come from? Hezekiah. Revelations. Hezekiah. He said, you just need to come stand in what I'm standing in. And you'll know why. He said, first off, not only were five of the churches rebuked, but yet the very reason why he came, why the Lord came to John for a letter to be sent to the seven churches, because it was all about their spiritual condition. And the church that modern day America would want, that moderns their church after, is the church that the Lord rebuked. Do you know, I firmly believe, I forget who said this, I don't know if it was A.B. Simpson or somebody, I think it was A.B. Simpson, but he said these words. He said, if the Holy Ghost was taken out of the church today, 95% of all the stuff that was done in the church would continue to go on, and people wouldn't even know, 5% of the people would not even know he's left. Right. But yet, if you took him out of the church, the early church, I don't even like that term, but just for argument's sake, the early church, if you used to take the Holy Ghost out of the church in the book of Acts, guess what? 95% of all the stuff that was going on would stop. Why? Because they did it by the Holy Ghost. They were connected to heaven. They sought Him.
Yeah.
And they did what He said.
Yeah.
They followed the Holy Ghost. Not what they wanted. Not because it sounded good. They didn't send out surveys and send out questionnaires and what is it that you would like. And it's not about that. It's about what He wants.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
It's about what He wants. Trust me, if the world likes the church, then God abhors it. Amen.
Amen.
And yet the very church that this is would be the model church. And yet even when the Lord speaks to them, He congratulates them. He congratulates them on that they work hard. And He made it a point to let them know, hey, I want you to know that I know what you're doing. That you work hard, that you labor hard, that you will expose false prophets and apostles. Those that come around saying they're apostles, you're going to test them to find out if they really are. And He goes down the list of everything that they're doing right. But then he lets them know the main point of the letter. But I have something against you. That's what He said.
Right.
Even though after He told them they're doing everything right in their works, but yet when it came right down to it, they were more involved in the work of God than God Himself. They were more concerned about the work of God than having a relationship with Him. Now, if you was to ask them, do you love the Lord? They'd say, well, of course we love the Lord. But yet, if you ask the Lord, do they love you? You know what the Lord said? The Lord said, yeah, they love me, but just not first. He demands to be first. And He must be our number one priority. And if you would hear what the Holy Ghost says, there's a line being drawn. And I hear the words of the Lord. I hear the words of the Lord, especially in my time. Just when I'm thinking about Him, I hear Him saying unto me, come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. Because of the words I hear of the Holy Ghost. Come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. There's a line being drawn between those that are radical for Him and those that want to play church, but you live like the world. That every single one of us, He's priority. His kingdom's priority. And we're baptized in that fire, the Holy Ghost. And we go about our Father's business, not in church, outside of church. And we got to get out of this thing that you know, you people, I know people that's been talking to people, they need a miracle. Well, come to church tonight. Forget about come to church tonight. You are the church. Pray for them. Cast the devil out of them right there. Get them healed right there. That's what the church does. Well, what are people going to think? Who gives a rip what people think? That's the problem. But you know what? The closer you get to Him, the more you draw nigh to Him, you don't care what people think. When people say, well, what are people going to think? That just tells me you're not very close to the Lord. Because you're more concerned with pleasing Him than pleasing man. Amen? And just go with me quickly to the book of Exodus. I don't know why I say quickly. We don't do anything quickly, but quickly. Exodus. I wanted to show you something. I'm going to pray. Exodus 33. You know, the most important, you ask people, what's the most important verse in the Bible? Most everybody's going to say John 3:16. And obviously that's an important verse. But I believe Genesis 1:1 is the most important. And in the beginning, God. Because it's all about Him. No, it's all about Him. It's all about Him. It's all about Him. No, it's all about Him. Everything in our life is totally surrounded and involved in Him. And when you get to know him, you understand why now he says all things are possible to him that believes. Because you get to know him, you begin to see. He begins to reveal himself to you. He begins to reveal himself to you. And you move beyond information. You move beyond information and you get into relationship. Because you begin to see your Father. Because he is your Father. Remember what Jesus said as he's going up, after he's resurrected, going to the Father? Remember what he said? I'm going to my Father and your Father. To my God, to your God. Meaning Jesus was saying, my God, your God, my Father is your Father. And that's the whole centerpiece of Christianity, is our relationship with God. To where you move from knowing about him, but do you begin to, you know him. You know him. No, you know him. No, you know him. You'll never know all about him because you can't exhaust him, because he has no beginning, he has no end. He's God. There's not enough capacity in your brain to understand. He's not there. But you begin to understand that he's the source of everything. Why is people say, well, why do you say Genesis 1 is the most important verse? Because in the beginning, God. Why? Because understand, he's the source of all things. He's the source of our being. He's the source of life. He's the source of it all. And we have to seek him with all of our heart. He must be first. He must be first. And when you get to know him, you get to begin to see who he is and begin to see how glorious he is, that you begin to see how big he is, that you begin to understand that he is the Almighty. My brassy friend. I actually been dwelling on that for the last couple of weeks. Bro, when God spoke to Abram in Genesis, I just get so full, you just got to let it out. You know what I mean? He's just so wonderful. But in Genesis 17:1, when the Lord came to Abram, soon to be Abraham, I am the Almighty. That's what he said. I am the Almighty. No, I am the Almighty. Abram, I am the Almighty. No, Abram, I am the Almighty. And when you understand who your Father is, that he is the Almighty, then you'll come to the place to where you will never fear ever again anything in your life. Because you belong to him. And you're the church. And we don't act like the world acts. We don't respond like the world responds. Poisonous snake come out and bite us. What do you do? Get off me. Because the life of God is on the inside of me. Because he came to give me life. He came to give me the life of God. And it's flowing on the inside of me. The life of God's in me. Now listen, sickness and disease can't touch your body when the life of God's flowing through it. Because life is greater than death. Life is greater than death. And the life of God's flowing in you. Cancer can't attach itself to your body. Why? Because the life of God's in you. Just like light overcomes darkness, the life of God overcomes death. His blessings overcome curses. Amen? Because the life of God's on the inside of you. And he came to give us not just life. He didn't even just come to give us abundant life. He came to give us life more than necessary. I know people say, well, is that really necessary? Oh, yes, it's necessary. Because you don't understand who my Father is, because he's mighty. He's the Almighty, and he's extravagant. Hello, he's extravagant. He's excessive. He said, you honor me with your tithes, and I'll open up the windows of heaven, pour you out blessing where there's not room enough for you to contain it. That's excessive, and that's who my Father is. But yet he said, if you seek me and put first his kingdom, then that'll overcome you. But it won't overcome you when you seek that. You got to seek him first and seek his kingdom first. You got to have your priorities right. And then all these other things will come. Abram, I am the Almighty. And even Abraham, here he is now. What has it been, Pastor Moore? Is it 20, 25 years? But prior to Genesis 17, the Lord said, I'm going to make a covenant with you. And they guess what? Abram and Sarah, they try to help God out. They try to help him out. Anytime you do anything in the flesh, you're going to mess it up. Anytime. Anytime you do anything in the flesh, you're going to mess it up. And we're still having problems with Abraham's mistake today. Because he tried to help God out. But yet, even in all that, that's what you have to understand, how good your Father is. Because people come to me, but you just don't know what I've done. No. See, that's the problem. You're bringing everything. You're bringing God's goodness and God's mercy down to the level of your mind, to where you can understand it. And that's why you think, well, you just don't know what I've done. No. You don't know who he is. Yeah, but if you just know what I've done in my life. No. If you just know how good he is, you wouldn't even talk like that. Because God's goodness is greater than any mistake you've made in the past. Come on. Because it's limitless. There's no beginning to his goodness. There's no end. Because there's no end. There's no beginning. There's no end to him. He's the Almighty. He's the Almighty. He's the Almighty. He is the Almighty. He's the Almighty. And guess what? The Almighty said that if you serve me and obey me, then you'll spend your days in prosperity and your years in pleasure. That's what he said. He said, the Almighty said that if you serve him and you obey him, then you'll be blessed coming in, you'll be blessed going out, you'll be blessed in the city, you'll be blessed in the field. He'll open up his treasure unto you. He'll command his blessing upon you. But, hello, he has to be first. Because he's the Almighty. And that's what he said, Abraham. Yeah, you made big mistakes. But Abraham, you don't know who I am. I promise that I'm going to do something, and I am the Almighty, and your mistake isn't greater than what I promised. Because he's the Almighty. Did you ever think about it? Listen, if you got your finger in Exodus 33, you hold it there, because I'm going to come back to something. I'm going to pull up something here. Something I was doing a study. Let me find it. I wasn't going to talk about this today. All right. In Psalms 33:6, God, with his word, created the heavens and the earth. But the Bible says, with his breath, Brother Dale, he created the stars and the host of heaven with his breath. And that got me thinking. I begin to see something. I just want to see, because he's the Almighty. And I just wanted to see what, if he's the Almighty, just what his breath can do. And I'll be honest with you, it's so magnificent and so incredible that I don't even know where to put it. I can't put it in my mind, because it's so mighty what he did, Lucy, just with his breath. Bible says that with his breath he created the stars. Not only did he create the stars, he named them all. Who am I talking about? Your Father. Who is he? He's the one that we seek with all of our heart first. Who is he? The Almighty. El Shaddai, the God that's more than enough. And there's billions in him. How many scientists? Well, we know you pastors are scientists. Anybody else the scientists in here? Okay. There's billions of billions and billions and billions and billions of galaxies. There's more stars that we'll ever be able to number. But I begin to study, And I found, and I want to talk about just four stars. I'm not going to get in depth in it, but I just briefly want to show you this. Because I want to see what his breath will do. And I'll be honest with you, I'm going to reveal some of my ignorance. When I began to study this, I never knew that the sun was a star. But the sun's a star. How many know the sun's a star? A lot smarter than I was. I didn't even know it was a star. Hey, I went to school in Kentucky. And I went to school in Kentucky and I lived at the racetrack. So come on, give me a break. So I did this study. This is the breath of God. And I'm not going to get all into it, but I just want to show you something briefly. That the star, that the sun, that is so big that you can put 960,000 Earths in the sun. And that was created by God's... Now you understand why he says all things are possible. Now you understand why we fear nothing. Why we walk and live the life that we live, the life of the redeemed, free from all sickness, free from all disease, that which affects the world doesn't affect us. Why? Because our Father is God, and he's the Almighty. And with his breath, he created the sun. And you could put 960,000 Earths in the sun. The second star I found was a star by that called Betelgeuse or Betelgeuse. Not that funny, I didn't think, but Betelgeuse. They call it Betelgeuse. We call it Betelgeuse. Now listen, it's 427 light years away. Listen, it's 5.88 trillion miles away from the Earth. It's massive. But here's the thing that blew me away. This star is so big that if the Earth was a golf ball, now you know how, have anybody ever played golf? Golf ball is about like that. If the Earth was a golf ball, this star, Betelgeuse, it's so big that if the Earth was a golf ball, you could put the golf ball down beside the Empire State Building and stack six more on top of it. That's how big this star is. So next time you go to New York, take a golf ball, stick it beside the Empire State Building, and picture six more Empire State Buildings on top of that one. That's how big this star was. And God created it with his... Why? Because he's the Almighty. Actually, the star is so big that you can put 262 trillion Earths inside the star. Think about that. 262 trillion Earths inside the star, and God made it with his breath. Betelgeuse is so big that you could take, you know, the Superdome in New Orleans? It's so big that if the Earth was a golf ball, you can fill up the Superdome 3,000 times. That's how big the star was. And I can elaborate on all of them, but that's not really my whole point today. But look at the third star I tell you that I found is a star called Musifi. It's 2.7 quadrillion. You could put 2.7 quadrillion Earths in this one star. Now, listen, I already lost you. Because most Christians can't think beyond a million. Some can think in billions, but get past billions. Christians don't think in trillions. Christians don't even think, especially don't think in quadrillions. But that's because they don't know who their Father is, most of them. But when you begin to seek him with everything on the inside of you, he shows you, because you get a relationship with him, he shows you himself. And the only thing you'll be able to do is, wow, You won't be able to even say wow, because it's just, he's just so incredible. But isn't that, well, one more thing. That this star is so big. Well, I mean, I don't want to get into all that. And that's not even the largest star. The largest star is this. The largest star is called Canis Majoris. It's the largest star they found up to now. Listen, this star is so big that if the Earth was a golf ball, you can put 7 quadrillion Earths inside this star. If the Earth was a golf ball, you could fill the whole state of Texas with golf balls 22 inches deep. That's how big this star is. This star is so big. It's so big that if the Earth was a golf ball, did you go and put it beside Mount Everest? And that's how big that star is. Why? Why am I even saying this? Because I wanted to show you just how mighty he is. He's the Almighty. And we can't even contain all that he's done with just his breath. Because he's God. And that's why Moses, and I'm not even going to get into it, but that's why Moses said in Exodus 33, that's why Moses cried out, I want to know you. He said, Exodus 33, he said, show me your ways that I might know you. You hear the cry of Moses. Moses wanted to know God. You hear his cry, show me your way that I might know you. Show me your way. God said, I'm going to show you my presence. Moses said, if your presence doesn't go with us, then I don't want to be where your presence isn't. Think about the heart of Moses. If your presence isn't there, I don't want to be there. Because everything we need, and we should have that same thing, we should have that same way of thinking when it comes to wherever we go somewhere. If God's presence isn't that place, I don't want to be there. If God's presence isn't that concert, I don't want to be there. If God's presence isn't that so-called revival, I don't want to be there. Because if his presence isn't there, he's not there. Show me your glory. You know what God said? He said, I'm going to show you my goodness. You can't see me, Moses, but I'm going to let you see my backside. I'm going to let you see my backside. I'm going to hide you. I'm going to hide you in the cliff of the rock. And I'm going to pass by. And I'm going to allow you to see my backside. And Moses saw his backside. And we get 5 books of the Bible from it. It's like somebody come and say, I'm going to show you my new car, but I'm not going to let you see the car. I'm going to let you see the back of the car. I'm going to let you see my tailpipes. Hallelujah. But he's God. He is God. He's the Almighty. He's El Shaddai. And we must make him priority. He must be priority. And with all of our heart, with everything within us, we must seek him first. We must seek first his kingdom. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. I'm going to pray for you. Come here. What's your name? How old are you?
23.
Lift your hands. Whew. Father, in the name of Jesus, the fire of the Holy Ghost. Jesus, it's the same fire that baptized me. And I'm going to get into it tonight. I'm going to share some more with you. But that's the same fire that baptized me. Hallelujah. But I want to pray for you, sir. And is this your wife? Okay. I learned to ask, so that's why I ask him. I was in a church in Indiana. I said, sir, is this your son? He goes, no, it's my wife. I'm like, ooh. I learned to ask. Come here. Shukurabashi, lift your hands. In the name of Jesus, the fire of the Holy Ghost. Whew, that's it. Shubrahani frehita. The fire of the Holy Ghost. Jesus. Whew. See, but I want to pray for this man right here. Sir, right here. Yes, yeah, come here. Yeah, you. Yeah, you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Whew. I can look out and throughout the service, I can see the fire of God coming and setting upon me. I can see who what the Lord Brahma Freba Shisted is doing. The fire of God burning. Jeez. That's it. Oh, Rabba Sifre Pasifre. Oh, Rabban Sifre Pasifre Pasifre Bakita. See, here's the thing. The closer you get to him, the more full of him you get. To where you begin to walk into a room and the people be convicted of their sin. Hello? To where you walk down, when you walk down the sidewalk and your shadow overcomes the blind and they begin to shout and scream because they can see. No, we're the church. No, we are the church. And the Lord Jesus, he's the head of the church. He's the head of us. Amen? The very one we serve is the very one who said to Moses, when Moses said, who am I going to say sent him? I am that I am. Matter of fact, isn't it amazing when Jesus was in the garden, when they came seeking Jesus, when they said, we seek Jesus. Jesus said, I am. Isn't that familiar? We heard that with Moses, didn't we? I am. And guess what? The Bible says, there was so much glory in his words that every one of them hit the ground. I am. Hallelujah. Did you ever think about it? Jesus said, let me just show you some, just how big God is. Jesus said, if I wanted to, I could have got 12 legions. I could have got 12 legions of angels if I wanted to. I could have got 12 legions. How do you know how many is in a legion? How many knows a legion? Tell me. 1,000. He said, if I wanted to, I could have got 12,000 angels here. Actually, it's not. What is it? It's 12. Actually, here's the thing. Do you know in the Old Testament, one angel slew 185,000 men. One angel. He said, I could get 12,000. He said, I could have got 12 legions. If I wanted to, if one angel... I did the math. If one angel could slay 185,000 men, then guess how many 12 legions could slay? I added it up. Over almost 14 billion. There's not even that many people on the planet. There's 7 billion people on the planet. 12 legions of angels. Just 12 legions of angels can slay almost 14 billion men if one angel slew 185,000. What am I saying? I'm saying how big he is. And there's a whole lot more with you than against you. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, we win. No, we win. No, we win. No, we've already won. The reality is we already won. Come here, I want to pray for you. Come here. I seen it earlier. Hallelujah. Well, you felt it too, didn't you? Just as the service was going, you felt the fire of God fall on. Yeah, because as it's falling on me, I saw it falling on you. The fire of the Holy Ghost. He goes, oh, yeah. In the name. Oh, yeah. Jesus. Charesa. I feel a brosa. I feel a broba sifre. A fraba bosu pray undo. A refa has you pray a soprano pra. Ha 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 ha. Oh, rabba sifre. You know, if I film me, then go play it, and the power of God that's on me gets captured on that film, and you go play it in one of your meetings. Shoo, braba frapakita. Hallelujah. Well, I'm going to pray for some number of people. And we're going to pray for everybody tonight. But before I pray for some more people, just everybody just bow your heads, close your eyes. Oh, Rabban Jifre ba Shifre ba Kita, Shopro ban Difre ba Shiste Evrepa, Hura, oh, Rabba Sifre, oh, Rabba Frappa, Jesus, 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 Hura ba Shifre, the Prapaya, the Prapapaya, Brumba Prapapaya, Popo Papaya, Pire, Brumba Brepa Pire, Propo Prapa Pire, Paprapo Famba Shifre, Shipre and Dubrapa, Shifrena. Before I pray, I got two invitations for you this morning. You say, Brother Richard, I used to be on fire for God. I used to be on fire for Him, but I've grown cold. For whatever reason, whatever you went through, something horrible, experienced a death in the family or gone through a divorce or whatever reason that caused you from being on fire to where you're not really serving Him. I'm going to pray for you today. And perhaps you're here, you even say, you know what, preacher, I don't know Jesus. I don't know if I was to die. I don't know if I was to die today. I don't know if I was to die on the way home. I don't know if I would go to heaven. I don't know. You talked about there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shun. I don't know. But today I want to know. I want to make Him the Lord of my life. I feel something. I feel something, and it's good, and I want to make Him the Lord of my life. On any one of those two invitations to make Jesus the Lord of your life, to rededicate your life. Now I add one more. Perhaps you even come to church and the devil's been telling you you're not saved, but today you want to make sure. If that's you, I want you to raise your hand. On any one of those invitations, just raise your hand. Brother Richard, pray for me. Yes, sir, I see your hand. Anybody else, pray for, raise your hand. All over this auditorium, pray for me. I want to give Him my life. Yes, sir, I see your hand. Anybody else, pray for me. I want to rededicate my life. I want to make sure. I want to give Him my life. I want to serve Him. I want to serve Him. I want to know this one you're talking about. I want to know Him today. Raise your hand. All over this auditorium, just raise your hand up high so I can see. All over this auditorium, raise your hand up high. All right. Now I want everyone to look at me. If you did not raise your hand, you wanted to. You know you should have. And you wanted to, but you fought it, but you did not. You know you should raise your hand, but you didn't. Raise your hand right now. Brother Richard, pray for me. Just raise your hand. Okay, thank you. That's why I do this. Yes, sir, thank you. Anybody else, raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Anybody else, pray for me. Because there is a battle. Pray for me. Anybody else? I feel there's more. Pray for me, Brother Richard, pray for me. Pray for me. Just pray for me. I want to give you my life. I want to make sure. I want to rededicate my life to Him. Just pray for me. Raise your hand. Anybody else, raise your hand. All right. I'm going to do just like I said. Those of you, three of you, four or five, however many it was, that raised your hand, I want you to stand up. Hallelujah. Just stand up. Forget about who you're with. Forget about who you're with. Forget about who you came here with. Just come. This is between you. You and God now. You and the Almighty. Whew. Oh, are we doing communion today, Pastor? I just saw. Oh, it's always there. Okay. Come up here. What's your name?
My name is Vivian.
What?
Vivian.
What's your name, sir? And what's your name? Just know this one thing, Bill, Vivian, and John. You're going to leave this place today knowing that you know that you know that all's well with you and your soul. All's right with God. That if you used to leave this house today and, God forbid, get in an accident, yet you're right with Him. You're born again. His nature's in you. You go be with Him. That's the greatest thing in life. I want you just to pray this with me. Congregation, you pray this with us. Stretch your hands out to these three. Just raise your hand. The three of you, just raise your hand. Congregation, pray with us. And just pray loud enough to where you can hear yourself pray. Say this with me. Dear God, I come to you right now. You said if I'd come to you, you'd not turn me away. And I come to you now. And I believe that you sent your son Jesus. That he walked this earth for 33 years. that he was scourged for me.
He was scourged for me.
That he was nailed to a cross for me.
And
he shed his blood.
Blood.
That I might have life. That I might have his life. And you said, if I would confess you as my Lord and ask you to forgive me of all sin, that you'd forgive me. Come into my life right now. Come into my heart right now. I confess you as Lord and Savior. And I make this decision that I will serve you all my days, that I'll walk with you all my days, that whatever you want me to do, I'll do. My life no longer belongs to me, but my life belongs to you. It's no longer I that lives, but it's Jesus that lives in me. Now I'm going to pray for you. Now, Father, that's the power of God on you, sir. That's the power of God. You're never going to be the same. You'll never, ever be the same again from this day on. You'll never be the same. You'll never be the same. You'll never be the same. Oh, yeah. You're in the fire of heaven. Jesus, never the same. Never the same, Vivian. Jesus. Jesus. I know people say, well, what they go to their church, what are they doing up there? It's none of your business, really. You know, there's times, you know, there's one time I felt such a draw of the Lord. I answered my own altar call one time, one of my own revivals. I did. I answered my own altar call. I felt the pull. I just felt it. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands, Lord. We worship you. 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 We Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We worship you. 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 We worship you, Jesus. The fire of the Holy Ghost. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. Oh, Rabba Rifa Shista Rabokota. This sister right here, come. We worship you. Come here. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. Just lift your hands. Oh, Rama. Never the same. Never the same. Never the same. Gee, never the same. Oh, yeah, the same. Never the same. Never the same. Never the same. Oh, Rabba Sifre Basita. Oh, come here, come here. Oh, manele, so ramane. Oh, ranele, lelele, lebrori, sanele. Shura bakita. Oh, rabasifre. Oh, ranele, bre satan. Foy, bre, romandele, le basita. Oh, ramani, re basita. This girl, bring her right here on the front. Come here, come here. Oh, remanele breu sombra na brosata. Stand right here. Oh, ramanele na brune. Reba supreya. No, ramanele rebefata. Oh, ramanele brupahata. Come here, you two. You two. Oh, ramanele breposito. Ramanele broposete. Oh, Ramanele, proposo, Ramanele, bosata. Oh, Ranele, lele, lele, stare. Lift your hands. Oh, Ramanele, oto. Jesus. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, my. I know how you feel. Oh, Shifre. Oh, Rahasite. Oh, Hallelujah. I tell you, everyone, just stand. Just everyone stand. Tonight, we're going to make a point. We're going to pray forever. You don't want to miss tonight. Now, if you're on the ground, you don't have to get up. I'm not dismissing. I'm not dismissing. Lift your hands. Father, that same fire that fell on the day of Pentecost, Lord, that same fire that you baptized me with, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, let that same fire fall in this house now in the name of Jesus. Fire, 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 fire. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But there it is right now. There it is right now. The fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire, 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 the fire. Oh, Rabba Baba. Oh, Rabba Baba. Oh, Brabba Sabrina. Oh, Rabba Baba. Oh, Rabba Baba. Oh, Rabba. The fire, the fire, the fire, the fire, the fire, the fire. Oh, the fire. Oh, the fire. Oh, the fire. Oh, Rabba Baba. Oh, Rabba Baba. Oh, Rabba. Oh, oh. I'm just going to tell you this. God brought you here, and you're in the plan of God. And the Lord's heard your cry. The Lord's heard your cry. The Lord's heard your cry. He's heard your cry. And all the things that He's told you, the things that's been in you, will be fulfilled. They will be fulfilled. They will be fulfilled. They will be fulfilled. But you're in His steps. He brought you here. You're in His plan. Wait and see what the Lord's going to do. I see it. In the spirit I saw it. It's bigger than you. I'm just telling you, I saw it. It's bigger than you. It's bigger than you. We're not done yet, but we will see you tonight. But I'm just going to hand it over to your pastor now, and you're going to flow in the Holy Ghost. Woohoo!
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for bringing us to the Father, for introducing us to the Almighty. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, living God. Lord, we yield our lives to you. We hold nothing back from you. Fill every dimension of our lives continually. Fill every dimension of our lives continuously. May we live for nothing other than you alone. Strengthen us right now. Strengthening us right now by your Holy Spirit. That everything that you've purposed for us, we will be empowered to receive it, enabled to receive it, yielded to you to receive it. And Lord, we pledge to you to obey you, to walk in the Holy Ghost, to live in the life of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, listen, make sure that you come back tonight. I don't want to have it one crowd in the morning, one crowd in the evening. Find some people that usually only come in the morning and bring them with you tonight in the evening. And are there anybody else that you can go and glean in the harvest? Richard's going to pray for everybody tonight. Jesus is going to pray for everybody tonight. Holy Ghost is going to pray for everybody tonight. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Woo! Find a bunch of, I don't even want to stop, but you know, we just have to always just do this because you got to go do things. But don't allow the flow in any way to diminish between now and the time we get back here around 5 for prayer, 5:30, show up for prayer. 6 o'clock, we'll start the meeting, okay? Come full of the Holy Ghost. Come full of the Holy Ghost. Come filled up. Come so submitted to the Spirit of the Lord that you can begin to participate as a member in the body of Christ Jesus. Just let the shout be so strong that really Richard barely even gets a chance to even preach, okay? Just let the flow be. Everybody with tongues and interpretation and tongues, and everybody prophesying, my goodness. And everybody with a flow of miracles and the glory of God through your life. Come on, just do that, okay? Find a bunch of people around you right now. Hug them, tell them that you love them. Bless them in the name of Jesus. Amen.